It's great to be here to speak with you all and tell you a little bit about the work that we're doing to try and find new ways to promote the development of the lung in premature babies, as well as to help the lungs repair after injury. So even just before a baby is born, the lung is extremely immature. And this fact was really highlighted by the premature birth and death of JFK's youngest child, Patrick Kennedy, in 1963, from respiratory failure due to the immaturity of his lungs, born after being only five and a half weeks premature. And this high-profile death really highlighted to the country a national recognition of the problem of prematurity and the consequences, and really accelerated advances in the therapies and research for premature infants, and have allowed today infants like you see here, who are born as early as 17 weeks premature, to survive. However, babies who are born premature are still right in the middle of lung development. As you can see here, the five stages of lung development span the entire pregnancy, beginning with the formation of two tiny lung buds, followed by successive and repetitive branching to eventually form the complex tree-like structure that you see there, with the smallest branches ending in very tiny air sacs. And it is during the final stage of lung development, called alveolarization, where larger lung saccules divide into tiny air sacs and dramatically increase the gas exchange surface area of the lung. And each of these tiny air sacs, called alveoli, are covered in a network of small blood vessels where deoxygenated blood enters, and within the alveoli, carbon dioxide is exchanged for oxygen, and the oxygen-rich gas can then be delivered to the rest of the body. At the completion of this process of alveolarization, the adult lung contains over 500 million of these small air sacs or alveoli, and if you opened each air sac up and laid it end to end, it would cover the surface of a tennis court. Now, in contrast to a baby that's born at full term, whose lungs are already in the process of alveolarization, for example, my daughter seen there, born at 39 weeks gestation, a baby who's born early, for example, at 23 weeks gestation, survives despite the fact that the lungs are only just starting to form those larger air saccules. However, premature birth at this stage in development disrupts the normal pattern of lung development, and many of these babies go on to develop a form of chronic lung disease that we call bronchopulmonary dysplasia. Now, bronchopulmonary dysplasia was first described here at Stanford in a landmark paper published in 1967 in the New England Journal of Medicine by Dr. Bill Northway, who's one of our pediatric radiology faculty. And in this original report, Dr. Northway described a group of premature infants who were treated with mechanical ventilators and high levels of oxygen-rich gas. And many of these babies developed a form of lung disease or bronchopulmonary dysplasia that was really a type of severe lung injury, in large part secondary to the complications of the life-saving therapies themselves. Well, with advances in medical care that have allowed even smaller and more premature babies to survive, as well as a better recognition of the complications of our therapies, a new form of this disease of BPD has now emerged. And rather than being a form of lung injury, this new form of BPD is really a disorder of disrupted lung development, with babies developing new BPD having larger and fewer air spaces, thus dramatically decreasing the amount of surface area that's available for gas exchange. Now, the development of bronchopulmonary dysplasia not only affects short and long-term lung function, but also affects the growth and development of other organs. So babies who develop BPD often have an increased need for significant respiratory support in early childhood, supplemental oxygen, some of them need tracheostomies or at times on a mechanical ventilator. They're also at risk for recurrent hospitalizations for what would be otherwise mild childhood illnesses. They also develop at a greater rate other lung diseases, such as asthma or emphysema. Interestingly, babies who have BPD are also at greater risk for problems of the brain. They have a greater risk for developing neurodevelopmental delays and impairments. And as you can see here in this picture of patients that were taken care of by Dr. Obradovich, BPD is also associated with impairments in growth. As you can see in these two premature twins, one of which who had BPD and one of which who did not. Now, well, the immaturity of the lung during late pregnancy and immediately after birth heightens the susceptibility of the lung to injuries that disrupt its development, it seems that the same quality affords the immature lung a tremendous capacity for repair and regeneration. And this was really first observed in rodent models where after removing the entire side of the lung, as you can see there in that schema, the left lung, the remaining side of the lung will grow and develop new alveoli to such an extent that the entire gas exchange surface area is completely restored within 2 weeks, which is really quite extraordinary. And what's very interesting to me in my work is that there are reports in infants and young children of similar degrees of compensatory lung growth after removal of part of the lung. And this is in contrast to adult patients who really don't appear to have the same degree of regenerative capacity. So as my work as a pediatric intensive care physician working here at Packard for over 10 years, I have seen firsthand really dramatic examples of the ability of young children to recover after injury. And this is a patient that we took care of, some of the nurses from the PICU are in the audience who know him well. 2 years ago, Dominic was in our ICU having really severe pneumonia from influenza H1N1, or swine flu. And Dominic's lungs were so severely injured that they weren't able to perform gas exchange, even with the help of a mechanical ventilator. So Dominic was placed on a machine called ECMO, which is a form of cardiac bypass, where the lung was removed from his body and oxygenated by a machine and then returned to his body. And usually when we put patients on this ECMO machine, they're on it for a number of days, maybe a few weeks, and Dominic needed this machine for over 40 days. There were many of us who were really worried that he would not survive, but he did. And not only did he survive, but his lungs started to get better. And they got better enough that he came off the ECMO machine and he came off the ventilator. And now when you look at Dominic, he looks like a normal child. And there's really no evidence that he has any lung function abnormalities. And we know that the pathways that guide lung development are reactivated in times of lung injury and promote lung regeneration. So we really think that knowing how the lung develops, and particularly how this alveolarization process occurs, will allow the discovery of new therapies that can not only promote lung development in premature babies, but can also enhance lung regeneration in older children and people like us. So one of the events that we know is absolutely essential for alveolarization is the growth of the pulmonary blood vessels. And it was found that in those babies who die of BPD, their lungs have decreased numbers of pulmonary blood vessels and decreased factors that stimulate blood vessel growth called angiogenic factors. And in animal models, if you block the blood vessel growth, you block alveolarization, and you result in a more simplified lung that's very similar to what we see in patients with BPD. Moreover, in those same animal models, if you give back those angiogenic factors, you can enhance alveolarization during injury. So we believe that if you can identify novel factors that stimulate blood vessel growth in the lung, that you might be able to find new ways to promote lung development and lung regeneration. And that's really been the focus of our research for the past number of years. So in alveolarization, blood vessel growth occurs via a process of angiogenesis. And angiogenesis is simply the growth of new blood vessels from existing vessels. And all blood vessels in the body are lined by specialized cells called endothelial cells. And in response to signals from the microenvironment, these endothelial cells can become activated, prompting them to proliferate and migrate, forming a new branch of a vessel. Now, in the lung, the majority of this angiogenesis, or blood vessel growth, occurs during early alveolarization, and very little blood vessel growth occurs during adulthood. So we wanted to understand better, why is it that lung blood vessels only grow during this very small window of lung development? So what we did is we started comparing these endothelial cells that form blood vessels from young lungs and from old lungs. So when we studied the endothelial cells that were taken from the lungs of mice in this early alveolar stage, we found that those endothelial cells were activated, that they grew and moved very quickly. In contrast, if we looked at the endothelial cells taken from the lungs of adult mice, older mice, these endothelial cells appeared unactivated or quiescent. They moved very slowly, they grew very slowly. So we wanted to understand more about these two cells. What was really conferring this difference in these two cells? And we thought, well, either the cells were just very different by nature, or could it be that the cells were actually very similar, but that they were responding to different signals in their microenvironment? So for example, could it be that the early alveolar lung was secreting factors that activated the endothelial cells and allowed blood vessel growth, whereas in the adult lung, the absence of these factors prevented the endothelial cells from being activated and prevented blood vessel growth? So in order to test this hypothesis, we developed a system where we could collect the secreted factors from the lung at different stages in development. And we found that if you take adult cells that aren't activated and you add factors secreted by the early alveolar lung, you can activate those adult cells. And they start to move faster, and they start to grow faster, and form blood vessels better. So then we said, well, what are those factors? Let's find out what those factors are. So we used an approach called proteomics, where you can compare hundreds of different proteins at the same time. And we compared proteins secreted by lungs at different stages of development. And out of over 500 differentially expressed proteins, we selected two. One was called alpha-fetoprotein, and the other TGF-beta-induced protein. And I'm not going to go into the specifics of these two proteins, but I will say that they were selected because both of these proteins were found to be only expressed in the lung during early alveolarization, that both of these proteins can activate the adult pulmonary endothelial cells, and both of these proteins make the adult cells move faster and grow faster. So our work now is really focused on studying these factors more and trying to understand, is it that these factors are decreased in diseases like bronchopulmonary dysplasia and diseases where alveolarization and angiogenesis doesn't occur? Are each of these two proteins necessary for blood vessel growth to occur? And really, most importantly, can you therapeutically replace these proteins in situations where you have lung injury and help promote or enhance lung regeneration? And I just wanted to acknowledge everyone who participated in the work of this project, and of course thank, most importantly, support from the department and from the Children's Health Research Institute for this work.